So tonight we are delighted to welcome our friend and comrade, Dr. Vandana Shiva, whom I regard as a sister, who really needs little introduction. She is a rock star in the worldwide battle against genetically modified seeds with a huge record of accomplishments, not to mention her 9 honorary PhDs, plus her earned one. In 1991, she founded Navdanya, a national movement to protect the diversity and integrity of living resources, especially native seed, and to promote organic farming and fair trade. For the last 2 decades, Navdanya has worked with local communities and organizations serving more than 500,000 men and women farmers. Navdanya's efforts have resulted in the conservation of more than 3,000 rice varieties from across India, and the organization has established 60 seed banks in 16 states across the country. Dr. Shiva has contributed in fundamental ways to changing the practice and paradigms of agriculture and food. She is a renowned writer and has authored more than 20 books. She has been called the Gandhi of grain, and she received the Right Livelihood Award, often called the Alternative Nobel Prize, for her activism on behalf of ecology and women. Time Magazine, The Guardian, Forbes, and Asia Week have all placed her on lists of the world's most important activists. We are deeply privileged to have the opportunity to listen to her speak tonight, one of the great orators of our time. After Vandana delivers her lecture, she will be joined in conversation by a very special guest, environmentalist, writer, activist, lawyer, and leader of the Green Party of Canada, Elizabeth May. Ms. May has a long record as a committed advocate for social justice, for the environment, for human rights, and for economic pragmatic solutions. She is an environmentalist, author of 7 books, activist and lawyer, who has been active in the environmental movement since 1970. She first became known in Canadian media in the mid-1970s through her leadership as a volunteer in the grassroots movement against proposed aerial insecticide spraying on forests near her home in Cape Breton Island, Nova Scotia. Elizabeth became executive director of the Sierra Club of Canada in 1989, a position she held until March 2006, when she stepped down to run for leadership of the Green Party of Canada. She will join us later in the event. And now, please welcome Dr. Vandana Shiva to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you so much for such a warm welcome. Thank you to the India Summer Festival team and my son, who insisted that I cannot drop out of this one. And thank you to my wonderful Guru Ben and Guru Bhai, Ratna and Aran, and their family, to Sirish, who has literally seeded the future, as he mentioned. And you know, the word bija and the word seed doesn't apply only to plants. Seeding is all species. And in Sanskrit, bija is derived from ja, which is life, and Bija is life arising on its own forever and ever. It is really the embodiment of permanence. Permanence that lies latent for a little while, and you would think the seed is dead. But you put it in the soil and it gets the right moisture and out it bursts. In Navdani, I've saved seeds that 40 years they were lying in someone's little bin. 40 years later, they still germinate. And seeding the future for me really is the recognition of the potential of life to burst forth in spite of the impression and the false assumptions that the soils are dead. The seed, they're trying so hard to write laws where they want to call the seed plant propagating material. And then the plant itself is purely raw material for commodities. So life gets more and more distance from life itself. And there is this arrogance that the more you can exploit life and her processes, the more you're producing, the more you're creating, and every instrument created during the wars and after the wars are this measuring of exploitation and destruction as creation. Whether you look at GDP, all that GDP measures is destruction of systems that renew and self-organize. Because its definition is, if you produce what you consume, you don't produce. So an old growth forest doesn't produce. When it's chopped down, suddenly there's production. A beautiful river flowing free doesn't produce. You dam it up. Site C, I hear all the time. You dam it up, kill the river, now you are generating electricity. Even though the river itself is the power. And we have beautiful movements in the Himalayas. They want to build 500 dams on the tributaries of the Ganges, which is the region where I come from. 500 dams. There'd be a dam, and there'll be the next dam, and the next dam. There'll be no river. So the movement that's been built basically says, the Ganges is our mother. She's not just for dipping in to wash your sins. She has a right to flow. She has a right to flow aviral, forever uninterrupted, and nirmal, without pollution. Now, it's basically, like this beautiful life on Earth, on this beautiful planet that sustains us all and gives us the food. It's taken 4.6 billion years for these creative processes to create the 300 million species, of which we are only one. And it's good to remember with humility that there are others. And in the philosophy of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, which I grew up with, which is still my philosophy, Vasudeva, Vasundhara, is one name of the earth as our divine mother. Vasudeva Kutumbakam is the earth family. And we are just one species in the 300 million, which is why, for those of you who come from India, you'll have heard 300 crore devta. Yeah, every living thing is an embodiment of the divine, and therefore the tulsi plant or the Ganges or the mountains, everything is sacred. And it's the same for the indigenous cultures here, and we were just welcomed with a beautiful song. I mean, I didn't understand the words, but I understood the music. 4.6 billion years, and we only arrived 200,000. We are so young as a species. And we did stumble along 10,000 years, learned how to farm. Some of the regions were destroyed. And this beautiful ancient Indian Veda which says, in this handful of soil lies your future. Take care of it, it will take care of you and sustain you. Destroy it, it'll destroy you. And the story of destruction of civilizations is really the destruction of soils and their capacity to sustain us. So the only societies that have survived over time are the ones that took care of the earth. 75 years ago, in some labs in Germany, they started to develop chemicals with only one objective, killing efficiently. And the chemicals that were used in the concentration camps and the chemicals that were used in the war, the poison gases and the nerve gases, really became precursors of industrial farming. For me, Silent Spring has always been a deep inspiration. And between Silent Spring and Albert Howard's Agricultural Testament, I think those two books tell you both of the harm that's been done by an agriculture that came from war, as well as the possibilities of a non-violent relationship with the earth. Rachel Carson writes, in the course of developing agents of chemical warfare, some of the chemicals created in the lab were found to be lethal to insects. Some of them became deadly nerve gases, and others of closely allied structures became the insecticides. So basically, what is called industrial farming is a continuation of war, because the tools that are used come from war. Even what seems to be quite harmless, the chemical fertilizers, came from war industry. The same labs that made ammunition, the same factories that made ammunitions and bombs, were used to make nitrogen fertilizer. And the slogan was bread from air. That we are creating bread from air. No, all that was happening is fossil fuels were being used, huge amounts, in order to blast the fossil fuels at very high temperature and very inefficiently do what our nitrogen-fixing pulses do non-violently. So it takes the equivalent of 2 liters of diesel to make 1 kilogram of nitrogen fertilizer. And the energy needed to manufacture the fertilizers we're using in 2000 was 191 billion liters of diesel and is expected to rise to 277 billion by 2030. So it wasn't bred from air, it was a fossil agriculture. And an agriculture based on war chemicals. And if you just look at what have these nitrogen fertilizers done, the first thing is they demand huge amounts of water. If you talk to farmers, they'll say they kill the soil, they burn the soil. And the only way to keep the soil going is to apply more and more irrigation. When I did my book on the violence of the Green Revolution, I found it was 10 times more water to produce the same amount of food. Which is a reason wherever industrial farming has been spread, water conflicts have grown. Because the demands for water become 10 times more than the sustenance capacity of that ecosystem. And on the other hand, ecological agriculture actually increases the capacity of your ecosystem to have water. With 0.5% organic matter, the soil can hold 80,000 liters. So there are 3 reasons why drought is increasing. The first is your soils have no capacity to hold water because the chemicals have absolutely killed the humus, which acts like a sponge. You're having to extract more water to keep the soils irrigated. And in addition to that, the same system of farming is responsible for 50% of the greenhouse gases that are leading to climate change. This was why I wrote my book, Soil Not Oil, before the Copenhagen negotiations, because agriculture was being totally left out of climate discussions. Both the pressure on the climate cycles and the carbon cycle and the nitrogen cycle from industrial agriculture and its emissions, but also the fact that ecological agriculture is the way to heal those cycles. And at the Paris summit last year, the French government launched a campaign which basically said if you have 0.4% organic matter, then we can pull out the emissions that have built up as stocks in the air, and the gap of 10 gigatons can be met. Because everyone's throwing up their hands and saying, can't pull down the emissions. No, the Earth has given us a process to complete that cycle. And even though we've put out too much, the soil, the plants, the photosynthesis, yesterday at dinner, David mentioned the miraculous process of photosynthesis. We're not even remembering that there are ways to heal. And all we have to do is align ourselves with the amazing processes. But there are other things these nitrogen fertilizers have done. You've been reading of dead zones, which increase by the day. When all of that nitrogen is running off into water bodies and oceans, it's killing life. And a large part is going into the atmosphere, and the nitrogen oxides are 300 times more damaging for climate change than carbon dioxide is. And then drinking water with nitrate pollution is causing its own problems. The pesticides that grew out of those labs are called science. And yes, the labs of Nazi Germany developed very high expertise in science, but it was a science of killing, not a science of maintaining life and renewing life. And that's the issue. That tools that are efficient in killing can't be the tools we use to live on this earth and to produce our food. And that's why every time they say technology, innovation's being blocked even now for this beautiful function you've organized. Some person is writing and saying, they should have got an expert rather than Vandana Shiva funded by the anti-GM interests. No, we are not anti-GM interests. We are pro-Earth interests. We are pro-people interests. And this is a very tiny group, very, very tiny group that has defined the making of tools of killing and war and destruction as their only objective and end of life. And we've got to help them. Remember, they are higher ends. The higher ends, we call it Purushartha. We call it Ritha, the right way. Now, having built up all of these tools of warfare, after the war, these factories then closed down. They just redefined chemical warfare as agrochemical inputs. An entire agriculture of 10,000 years and knowledge was erased for an agriculture based on warfare. To introduce it to countries like mine, it was given a name called the Green Revolution, which was not green and it was not a revolution. It was even given a Nobel Peace Prize, that out of these chemicals will come prosperity. Out of these chemicals will come the end of hunger. Look at the data today. The more hungry people, permanently hungry, than has ever been the case in human history, 1 billion. We've had hunger before, but it was always localized in space and time. Some people were hungry for some time because there was a drought. Some people were hungry for some time because there was a war. But wars would end and the drought would end and the hunger would go away. But this hunger is a structural hunger built into the design of the industrial agriculture system, which destroys the earth, the soil, the biodiversity, the water that feed us. And in addition to that, creates what I have called a negative economy, where it costs more to produce than you can ever earn out of agriculture. So most of the hungry people of the world today are farmers. They're growing commodities, not food, and they're not able to feed themselves. So 1984, there was a terrible eruption of violence in Punjab, and the Golden Temple was invaded with the Indian Army. And of course, now it's coming out that all the international forces were very involved in planning that invasion. I had been keeping track of what was going on in Punjab because I was doing a major program for the United Nations University on conflicts over natural resources as part of a larger program on peace and global transformation. And on 4th of June, when the army was sent, 4th of June was the day the farmers had said, we will not supply grain to Delhi anymore. Because the Green Revolution had defined Punjab as the breadbasket of India. But this is what it was doing to Punjab. This is what the Sharbat Khalsa decision read. If the hard-earned income of the people or their natural resources of any nation or region are forcibly plundered, if the goods produced by them are paid arbitrarily low prices, while the goods bought by them are sold at high prices, and in order to carry on this process of economic exploitation to its logical conclusion, the human rights of people or a nation are crushed, then these are indices of slavery of that nation, region, or people. Today, the six are shackled by the chains of slavery. This was presented as a religious conflict. It was not. The people being killed were the managers of Bhakra Dam, those in charge of research stations for Green Revolution agriculture. It wasn't Hindus and Sikhs, any way you can't, because many families, the senior most child is offered to Sikhism in Punjab. So in the same family, you will have Sikhs and Hindus. And in Punjab, the Hindus and the Sikhs will read the Guru Granth Sahib and will all go to the Gurdwara. So it was very artificially created, and that problem hasn't really stopped of refusing to see the roots of the problem in a violent and non-sustainable relationship with the earth, which then creates a crisis, creates discontent, creates anger, and instead of changing the model of exploitation, protect the model of exploitation and criminalize the victims. So last year was the year of soils, and this was when, you know, all these boats were crossing the Mediterranean and they were sinking, and I was extremely troubled with the refugee crisis. So I chair an international commission on the future of food, and I called some members of the commission and I said, we must look into this. In the year of soil, the relationship between soils and the uprooting of people, which is what a refugee is. And the two places that are today big stories in conflict are Nigeria, and you read about Boko Haram, and of course Syria. The story that doesn't get told is that 2009, Nigeria, as well as Syria, Northern Africa and the Middle East, had a very severe extended drought, part of climate change. But before that, similar green revolution model of commercial crops, thirsty crops, extraction of the last drop of water, had made the ecosystems already very vulnerable to drought. So the Lake Chad, where the Boko Haram is now recognized to be, was 22,000 square kilometers. Just in the last 20 years, 80% of the water of that lake has been diverted by dams for irrigation for cash crops. The lake is drying up. The pastoralists and the settled agriculturists are in conflict. And across Africa, including Sudan, the settled agriculturists are the ones who became Christians, whereas the nomadic pastoralists stayed Muslim. So when a conflict between pastoralists and agriculturists happens, it is then mutated very quickly by global interests into a religious conflict, and very rapidly into extremism. Same as for Syria. 1 million peasants were displaced in 2009. And 1 million people walking into cities will anyway create instability. Then if you go into detail, structural adjustment, World Bank, World Trade Organization treaty said you can't give relief to farmers. So the Assad regime could not give relief to farmers. But that same war industry that has fed the inputs to chemical farming and industrial agriculture and the Green Revolution, you know, it has a very direct interest in selling more arms. And it's not an accident that today the Fertile Crescent, which gave us agriculture, is under siege, is being absolutely devastated. Its other consequences are also there to see how with every step of this denial, because it is a denial, it's a denial in recognizing that the real problem is the war against the earth. And that war must stop if we've got to have peace in society. And you just have to look all around you today, that truck killing 80 people in France. But every day, there is a multiplication of conflicts. And in an integrated world, some violence, some harm, some injustice in one place is turning into an anger and discontent in another place. But unless we start looking at the roots or where it comes from, unless we start to realize that this beautiful planet is not just our home, it is our mother. And our first obligation is to take care of her. And 30 years of doing ecological agriculture now and saving seeds, I've realized that you take care of the earth, the rest just happens. You know, agriculture, it's basically the meaning of the word agriculture is the care for the land. Agriculture never meant production of commodities with chemical warfare instruments. Now that 75-year error of going off on the wrong track has created not just the problems for the planet, 75% of all ecological destruction is related to industrial agriculture. 75% desertification of soils, 75% depletion of water, pollution of water. In the case of seeds, in vegetables, 93% disappearance of crop varieties. And every time a plant variety and species is displaced, other species that depend on it are displaced. I feel so happy that, you know, in Navdanya, we save seeds. We never imagined we were going to save pollinators. But there's 6 times more pollinators on the Navdanya farm than in the forest next door. Because caring for diversity ends up caring for the entire web of life, which replenishes and renews itself. That monoculture thinking and a mechanistic thinking that was the basis of the production of the chemicals for warfare first, and then they became agrochemicals, led to a 20-year-old experiment of genetically engineering crops. Now, I happened to be at a meeting in 1987 where the old agrochemical industry said, we're not making enough money and we are too small, they said. The Sebas and the Sandozes said, we are too small, we got to get bigger, and we got to find a new way to make more profits. And the new way for them was using the tools of recombinant DNA to introduce genes into crops to have only one objective, to claim they had made something new, therefore they could claim it as their invention, therefore they could take a patent and take royalties. They weren't even talking, if you look at the records of the 80s and 90s, they weren't talking of feeding the world. They were talking of collecting royalties. And they said by the turn of the century, we'll be 5 companies. And they also said, the North America and Europe are too small a market. Therefore, we've got to have an international free trade agreement, which became the WTO. Monsanto is on record, its representative is on record saying, we wrote the intellectual property rights agreement of the World Trade Organization. We were the patient, the diagnostician, and the physician all in one. We defined a problem. And the problem they defined was, what is our dharma? Farmers save seeds was for them a problem. And they offered a solution, now it should be treated as a crime. That's the day I decided I am not going to stop my dharma of saving seeds. And any law that tries to make that illegal has to be treated like Gandhi treated the salt laws the British created. And they said, oh, India, hot, people need a lot of salt. Why don't we monopolize salt? Make it illegal for Indians to make salt. And Gandhi just walked to the beach, picked up the salt from the sea, said, nature gives it for free. We need it for our survival. We will continue to make salt. We will not obey your law. So we do the seed satyagraha like he did the salt satyagraha. And our pledge is, our pledge is, we've received this beautiful diversity from nature and our ancestors. We owe it to future generations to pass it on in the integrity and richness that we have received it in. And for us, the higher laws of creation, of Gaia, of the earth, the higher laws of our humanity and our being Earth citizens are the only laws that guide us. Corporations writing laws for themselves are not laws we will ever adhere to. And the fact that they hijack the word freedom in the name of free trade agreements, TPP, TTIP, and it doesn't stop. They're so desperate. They're so desperate to take away all freedoms because they know they cannot do honest business. They can only do dishonest coercion. Otherwise, they wouldn't need to force. If they were producing good food, they'd be very proud to put labels and say, this has GMOs. They hide because they know. Monsanto knew in 85 glyphosate Roundup is a carcinogen. Monsanto knew RBGH harms the health of animals and humans, but Shiv Chopra and others had to be sacrificed because the myth of the GMO miracle had to be maintained. So what did they give us in all of these years? Two applications. In my early debates, they used to say we'll grow food on the moon, in the Sahara Desert, and every toxic dump. Two pathetic applications. One, to put poison in the plant called BT toxin, and the other, to put a resistance gene so that more poisons can be tolerated by the plant. BT crops, herbicide-tolerant crops. In India, the BT has absolutely failed. Monsanto started to collect royalties illegally, and I brought case after case against them. They collected so much royalty, 80,000% jump in the price of cottonseed, 95% of the seed controlled by them, 300,000 farmers committing suicide, largely in the cotton belt, largely in the cotton belt. Well, we continued our work, we continued the research, and even though when I talk of suicides, they do one more article, PR. You know, they've got such a huge PR machinery. They just have to say, another attack, let's do another attack. And they keep trying to attack. But now the government of India is recognizing there's a serious problem. And because we've saved the seeds and we've distributed organic cotton seeds in Punjab last year when the white fly attacked, 27% decline in Monsanto's GMO cotton. And this is something we'll carry on. And you know, our local seeds, open source seeds, were declared primitive in the literature of the industry. Primitive seeds. But you know, for the indigenous people here, well, we've always been called primitive, we've always been called barbarians. I treat primitiveness as a compliment. Well, our primitive seeds are the ones that are rescuing our farmers now. And even the government institutions are saying, Desi varieties is the future. Desi means off the place, which means local, open pollinated. Well, two things happened with the Green Revolution and the GMO issue. On the one hand, with monocultures of rice and wheat, which you have to have with chemicals, you wiped out the diversity that feeds you. So, in our fields of wheat, we used to have mustard, we'd have chickpea, we'd have bathwa that would grow spontaneously, so rich in vitamin A, and amaranth varieties, both the grain up in the high Himalaya as well as the leaf amaranths. 250 species I have counted in the farms where spraying hasn't happened. Well, instead of just rejuvenating the biodiversity, which is the real source of removing hunger and nutrition, and our studies show we can feed two planets with adequate nutrition if we grow diversity, and that's what I write about in my book, Who Really Feeds the World? That's women and biodiversity and small farmers who feed the world. Not the chemicals and the corporations and the GMOs. That's not food in any case. So instead of bringing back diversity, which is what we do, the last PR stunt was mobilizing 107 Nobel laureates, one of them from the grave, to write a letter to Greenpeace to say, you're preventing golden rice. Now, golden rice has been experimented with for 24 years. It's not agronomically performing, and the content and its biofortification hasn't yet proven. So it's not a product yet available in the market. No one's blocking it except the stupidity of a reductionist paradigm. that assumes that the plant is a machine and you can fix it. Just add a yellow and suddenly you're going to have a miracle. You know, add a yellow, you put nice pulao. I mean, the only kind of yellow rice I would recommend is with turmeric or saffron in it. So, you know, 9th of August is Quit India Day, when in 1942, Gandhi told the British, time for you to quit India. It's the day we had bonfires of British clothing and of course, the whole movement for making your own cloth accelerated. So this 9th of August, we have a network of 5 million women organic producers, and we're asking 107 of them to volunteer to invite the 107 laureates for a feast of vitamin A rich food, which is also delicious and is rich in not just vitamin A, but iron and calcium and everything else that your crops can give you. But the other part of the story of amaranth is that even though for us it's a blessing, and amaranth, the word in Sanskrit and Greek, is derived from amar, which means forever, the perennial, that which lasts. And it is literally, it's called Ramdana in Hindi. It's become a super weed in the US farms. The Palmer amaranth is now a major weed. So if a beneficial crop has become a weed, a super weed, a normal intelligent mind would say, let's stop spraying glyphosate and let's stop having monocultures and it'll get solved. But a mechanistic, militarized mind cannot think that way. So what are they coming up with now? Yeah. 75 years of chemical warfare, 20 years of a GMO experiment, a two-year tool called CRISPR has suddenly emerged. And on the basis of it, they're creating what they're calling gene drives, and the National Academy of Science just put out a report saying, gene drives on the horizon. They're nowhere on the horizon, but they like to, you know, make it look like this is an inevitable future. This is how the NAS reports talks about gene drives. One possible goal of a gene drive modified organism is to cause the extinction of a target species. Simple, exterminate. So they're saying the problem is amaranth has become a superweed. The solution is, through gene drives, push the amaranth to extinction. And it so happens in India and China and Mexico, they eat it. And what are they thinking they're going to gain? Food security? By pushing a species to extinction. Now, part of the experiments they're doing is also with mammals. And you exterminate a mammal, you can exterminate other mammals too. And this logic of extermination, which began with the concentration camps and is becoming the ultimate solution for the errors, mistakes, and problems created by industrial agriculture, that mindset is what we are up against. But we can seed another future. We can seed another future because we know we can live at peace with all the species on this earth. And extermination was wrong in Hitler's Germany. Extermination is wrong in 2016. We have two clear parts. One is the path of extermination, and on the rate at which the destruction of the 75-year experiment of chemical warfare and genetic warfare in agriculture has destroyed so much. In a few years, they can wipe out the conditions of human life on the planet and life of most species. The sixth extinction is very much a product of the way we produce our food. But rejuvenating biodiversity can also be part of the way we produce our food. Now, there are four myths that are constantly brought up when you talk of the transition to organic farming and ecological agriculture. The first myth, it's going backward. Now, if there are two parts, and one is a dead-end abyss and a precipice, and the other is into a permanent future, I do not see how going into the future is going backwards. Because they always say, you're taking agriculture back to the Stone Age. The second big myth, which is including the poor 107 Nobel laureates, most of them didn't know what they were signing on because it was a PR exercise. It's always projected as science versus anti-science. For me, it's anti-science to not know how nature works. And just as Newton could not say to Bohr when quantum theory emerged, or to Einstein when relativity emerged, to say, you're anti-science because you're not mechanistic. Those promoting genetic and chemical warfare in agriculture can't say for those of us who want a non-violent farming, you're anti-science. The real people who are anti-science are those who refuse to know. Because all that science means, it's derived from the Latin sciere, to know. If you know the right thing to do, if you know other species have rights, if you know bad food causes destruction of the planet and disease, to not practice that knowledge is blindness, and that is anti-science. Another, it's too costly. Well, with $400 billion of subsidies and externalities left for societies to bear, we've done a book called Wealth Per Acre. We've calculated for India alone, environmental externalities are costing us $1.2 trillion a year. That's about as much as the GDP. And we didn't count health, but just take the budgets for cancer treatment, diabetes treatment, and just treatment, not even the human cost of what it means to have a family member with these food and agriculture-related diseases. That would be another $1.5 trillion. We are talking of such huge costs that if they were internalized and we did true cost accounting, we just couldn't afford chemical farming. We couldn't afford industrial agriculture. And then the issue of, oh, but organic can't feed the world. It's the only way we will feed ourselves. The industrial system is not a food system. Only 30% of the food is coming from the industrial system. Only 10% of the GM corn and soya is going into eating, and that too because there's no labeling. I think with labeling, even that would drop to zero. 90% is going to biofuel and animal feed. It's not a food system because food is supposed to nourish us, not destroy our health. And the combination of nutritional deficiencies, the fact this food is nutritionally empty and burdened with toxic chemicals, is becoming a major hazard to health. I was just reading an article this morning on how much of an increase has taken place in prescription in drugs, including addictive drugs like amphetamines. Yeah, and there's a drug called Adderall, and there's Ritalin, for a new disease called ADHD. There's been an 84% increase just in the last 10 years. But I've had doctors tell me that a lot of this attention deficit is coming from magnesium deficiency. And children fed organic food in the schools of England immediately went calm and started to focus. On the farm of Navdanya, we've just completed a study comparing the chemical farms where there was a loss of 70% of magnesium in the organic practices, we had a 14% increase. Zinc, which is related to depression. You don't need to take Prozac, just eat organic. 37% decline in the chemical, 14% increase. This brilliant study in the British Nutritional Journal, 70% more nutrients in organic food. Why do we measure weight of food? I call it Descartes' ultimate victory. When the measurement of weight replaces the quality of nourishment. So we are at this fork, and this fork is saying dead-end precipice and peace, prosperity forever on the other side. It's saying on this path you have a 1% economy, where 1% controls the economy of the 99% and displaces them. You know, 62 men, you could put those 62 men in a bus, or I would say, let's put them into a shuttle to export them. 62 men control as much wealth as 50% of humanity. And literally in 2 years' time, it'll be 1% controlling the 99%. That's economic dead end. That's the kind of problem that's leading to the violence in cities everywhere. Because beyond a point, polarization will lead to conflict and violence. Whether it be economic polarization or resource polarization, and then it becomes cultural polarization. These are the challenges we face. And in seeding the future today, just with a lot of love for the earth and her diversity, a lot of love for each other and say, I'm not going to grow food that's toxic for you or toxic for me. I'm going to grow good food that nourishes you. And we create more intimate relationships. Why? I mean, what was this crazy assumption food must be globally traded and it disappeared as food? It became commodities. Local food systems, ecological food systems, diverse food systems. We need to bring dignity back to food. And in seeding the future, we need to recognize that in the seed is all the potential we need. That seed, our love, our care, the intelligence in the seed, and the intelligence in each of us. And when they say, oh, fear-mongering, I say, no, we are not afraid. We just see that you are highly stupid. And we will not let powerful, stupid men destroy this planet and our future. Thank you. Thank you.
It's wonderful to have someone who can so clearly articulate
the larger
model. Oh, sorry, this microphone goes in and out. I hope it's all right. Is it not too bad? The larger model of militaristic, mechanistic thinking. And it put me in mind very much, and I don't know if you know of this concept, of the progress trap. It was written about in Ronald Wright's book, A Short History of Progress. And he described how we keep falling into this progress trap, where the mechanistic, well, he doesn't call it the mechanistic militaristic thinking, but it's the same model, leads us to think that our advanced thinking and technology and continually separating ourselves from anything that makes sense, but while celebrating how clever we are, that we hit a problem. And then we figure, there's a solution for that. So in my mind, one of the examples of a progress trap was deciding we can raise pigs. I don't happen to eat meat or pigs, but we can raise pigs indoors all the time. We can reduce the manpower in these mega pig barns. We have these in Canada. We've become the world's biggest exporter of hogs. Because we raise them in mega hog barns, where they're on slatted flooring in metal containers. They never get to turn around. It's an offense to them as living creatures. But no one has to touch them or go near them. They're fed with augers that put the food in front of them. And then we've created this problem of sewage lagoons because they're on slatted flooring. And it creates these huge sewage pumps. We never had this problem before, which then, of course, creates incredible nutrient pollution so that Lake Winnipeg now has toxic algae. It's a huge problem. But the progress trap solution was the pig's excrement has too much nutrition in it. It's too high in fertilization. Hence, the GMO pig.
Enviro pig,
you've heard of it. The ultimate, to me, the ultimate progress trap. Other people have said, you know what? If you raise the hogs, even indoors in a concrete floor barn, but you let them have alfalfa straw on the floor, you can sweep that up and compost it. And then, but do you want to comment on Canadian mechanized livestock agriculture at all? Because we've talked of the intrusion of militaristic, mechanistic thinking in growing food. But what it does to animals is something at another level of, as you said, put it so clearly, we mustn't be afraid, but we can say that these people are highly stupid. But would you want to comment on animal agriculture in the industrialized world?
I mean, first, if we really recognize that we are Earth family, then any relationship with animals has to be recognizing that they too have rights. They have rights to well-being. They have rights to freedom, the freedom to range free. And the reason this is not just violent but also stupid is because they make it efficient in saying, we now have pigs in this much square feet. What they don't calculate is the shadow acreage of all the animal feed. Because, you know, pigs like to clear up stuff. I remember Goa, you know. You had toilets on top and you had pigs down there. Absolute cleanliness. And at the end of it, they used to make sausages from the pigs and never had to flush their toilets into water. And we never a sewage problem. The feeding of soya bean, you know, we've done this book on pulses because this is the year of pulses. And we have a whole chapter on how the one bean has become so dominant. Most of it is for animal feed. Now, cows are called herbivores. Herb means grass. They never wanted to eat beans. And they're being forced to eat beans. So they're being tortured. The land of other nations is being destroyed. The shadow acreage of the animal feed industry is about 7 times the acreage. I know for Holland this was calculated for the Earth Summit. But I think it would be interesting to see how much acreage is behind those intensive farms. And you know, once I was going past California and I said, what are those big bunkers? And they said, CAFO. I said, what's a CAFO? Yeah. Concentrated Animal Farm Operations. I said, oh, they should be called animal prisons or animal torture chambers. Yeah. And not just the inefficiency. Look at it. You're growing food industrially, grain, using 10 times more inputs than what you produce. And then you're feeding it to animals, which is converting that protein into 1/10. So you're taking 100 units and turning it into one, and calling it efficient. And I think revisiting the ideas of productivity and efficiency is such an important part of the transition today, because all of it has been based on externalizing costs, increasing inputs, degrading quality, disposing with people, you know, because every step of productivity increases, how can you get rid of workers? And there's only one place we will get care for animals, only one place we'll get care for the earth, human beings. Yeah. They need to come back into the equation.
Yeah. Well, that's and I wanted to bring your analysis of what's happening globally, and of course of seed systems and of the efforts to... Oh, by the way, I wanted to start with a riddle, a joke that Maud Barlow told me. Do you know this one? What, it's appropriate in the church. What's the difference between God and Monsanto?
Well, Monsanto now says, God, move over. GMO. GMO is God, move over. We will now define ourselves to be creators of life.
Okay.
What's Maud's joke?
Maud's joke is, God's not trying to play Monsanto. So Monsanto and its maniacal interest in controlling all seeds. I deal with this as leader of the Green Party, and the accusation that Greens are anti-science by being concerned about genetically modified organisms, being in favor of labeling. And I say to people who want to argue the science, are GMOs safe for human beings to eat? Are GMOs not safe for humans to eat? This is the big debate, the way that, and the media wants to portray it as well. There are all these papers that say it's safe, and there's very few that don't say it's safe, so the people who are concerned about GMOs are anti-science. And I think it's much more powerful, and certainly true, without debate, that would any citizen in a democracy anywhere on earth think it's a good idea for one transnational corporation to control all the world's seeds? As a matter of corporate control and power, there's got to be something wrong with telling farmers you can't save your seeds. It's an absolutely outrageous proposition, but they get away with it because they get us slightly wrong-footed by saying, prove to us that you think our product is going to kill people. And I think it's a corporate power and control issue and part of the militaristic mechanistic thinking model that says, wait a minute, what corporation gets the right to control seeds? Farmers save seeds, and farmers have a right to a living, planting their fields and growing a crop and feeding people.
I definitely think this whole issue of not just monopolizing seed, but trying to claim you invented it, which is why I say GMO is God, move over. The reason it's happening, as I mentioned, they wrote these laws into WTO, but there were exclusions countries like India put in. We made laws, you know, I was part of the drafting of the Biodiversity Act, our Plant Variety Act is also called, and the Farmers' Rights Act. And the patent law has an exclusion which says animals and plants can't be patented, and biological processes can't be patented. So Monsanto's patents keep getting rejected in India. Argentina has similar laws, and Monsanto is suing Argentina right now in the Supreme Court. And I just made an amicus intervention to the Supreme Court to say, no, shooting a gene with a gene gun into a GMO is not the creation of the plant. The plant is creating itself, the seed is creating itself, because it's a self-organized autopoietic system. And this, I think, is a very central scientific issue of, is the act of shooting the creative act, or is the creativity in the seed itself? Horrible judgment in the Supreme Court of the United States. The farmer called Bauman bought seed, grain, in the marketplace, in an elevator. Soya, planted it, Monsanto sued, like they sued Percy Smyser after they contaminated his crop. And the judges ruled, because that's how the Supreme Court of the United States is functioning, they rule corporations are persons, and freedom of speech is stealing democracy. They've ruled that the seed replicating in a farm is a self-replicating machine of Monsanto stolen. No, the seed is not a machine. And this mechanistic idea, I think ordinary people are realizing life is not a machine. And manipulation is not progress and science. But I want to just share with you, I've just written an article on the great seed piracy. Because not only is Monsanto being bought up by Bayer right now, Bayer, Bayer, whatever you call it, the aspirin maker, but also the nerve gas maker, the concentration camp, IG Farben member. But Gates is playing a very, very big role. So 2 years ago, Gates Fund, first of all, they're destroying the public systems, including the public systems where seeds are held. It's called the CGAI system. 7 million collections. And he funded something called DivSeek, Diversity Seek. 7 million connections, just read their genome and patent. And they're doing it outside law. They're doing it outside the Biodiversity Convention. They're doing it outside any national and international law. And then this nonsense of the so-called CRISPR technology, most of the patents are held by either Gates himself or scientists he has financed. So the issue of corporate rule is really an issue of rich men's rule. And they're getting fewer in number. They're getting more secretive. And, you know, not only are they hiding ingredients in GMOs by denying label, they're hiding themselves. They're hiding their money in tax havens. They're hiding behind secret trade treaties. And they're wanting to create secret courts under the investor-state dispute settlement systems. Now, if you've got to hide so much, you're definitely doing everything wrong.
I'm glad you brought up investor-state agreements, because I think it's worth talking about them at least a bit, because it gives foreign corporations, and I think how many people in this church know exactly what I mean when I say investor-state agreements? So it's a minority. Investor-state agreements, the first one was Chapter 11 of NAFTA. They include what Canada has signed on to under our previous prime minister. You know, what's his name? I think it's good to get rid of that sense of gloom that we had for 10 years, you know. But but talk about secretive. Canada now ratified under the previous prime minister something called the Canada-China Investment Treaty, where we had no debate and no vote in Parliament, and Canada is bound to this thing for 31 years before anyone can get out of it. And any complaint by Beijing against Canada for any decision of our governments at the municipal level, the provincial level, the federal level, or a court, or a First Nation, any complaint by Beijing against Canada is secret. And they have 6 months of the beginning of the complaint period to get Canada to cave without telling anyone that we decided maybe we don't want to make Sinopec or PetroChina mad at us, so maybe we shouldn't bring back our Fisheries Act. I mean, that's a hypothetical, but it's pretty close up. So these investor-state agreements certainly don't have secret courts, because you can't use the word court about the arbitrary process that takes place with three lawyers in a hotel room somewhere, deciding that a government doesn't have the right to pass laws if they interrupt or interfere or reduce the expectation of profits of foreign corporation. So Monsanto has these rights against Canada because they're based in the US, but any US corporation can bring charges against Canada. The TPP, if we were being so foolish as to ratify that, would create 9 more countries with the right to sue Canada for decisions that we make to protect our environment, protect our health, and protect the common good. So how do you see in unraveling this? Okay, so we've got the World Trade Organization, we've got bilateral agreements for investor state rights, we've created a whole regime of intellectual property rights with the goal of protecting the 1%. What's our prescription for unraveling all of that and seeding democracy?
I think taking back our seeds, taking back our water, taking back our capacity to produce food, taking back our capacity to shape our education and our health systems, and part of it will be building alternatives, and part of it will be defending the public systems we've created through our democracies. It'll have to be multi-layered, and the old style of the perfect mast line won't work anymore. Because in some places, we'll be able to get rid of bad leaders, like your 10-year gloomy guy. But in some places, they won't go in a hurry. But in every place, I have found the three ingredients of seeding a future in the context of this, literally, what does investor mean? It means the guys who control big money. You know, they've renamed themselves investors. They're investing nothing. They're gamblers. They're speculators. And normally those kind of people, and they're organized criminals. Yeah, and those kind of people would be in jail. And so one is really, we've got to have a campaign to say, show yourselves. You know, come out in the open. The second is, we just have to make sure that our governments are not pushed into this. Because very often, you know, you have simple government servants who go to negotiate. But they are not negotiating. You have armies of these corporations and those who control them. But they're in every country. So it isn't that it's Canada versus China. It's not that it's India versus Europe. Because on both sides, the negotiating push comes with the lobbies. And it's the same lobbies on both sides of the table. So there's nothing like a negotiation anymore. I think the pretense of negotiation needs to be exposed. We need to reclaim freedom. The very word freedom. We've got to start mentioning that those treaties are not free trade agreements. They are totalitarian corporate rule impositions. And I want to just mention, you know, the first free trade treaty is actually not GATT and WTO or NAFTA. The first free trade agreement is the Right Honorable East India Company signing an agreement with a bribe of 50 rupees to a collapsing Mughal court to get access to India as a market, 1716.
I'm all in favor of show yourself. The shadow world operators, and a lot of what the climate crisis is about, is that we're dealing with organized crime.
Yes, we are.
In the fossil fuel lobby. Liars, cheats, who've been bribing governments and lying to people about the science for far too long. Now, there's some within those liars and cheats, there are a couple companies coming up and saying, we're ready for a carbon tax. We're ready to change our policies. But I do think when we know how Exxon is and Mobil and hiding the science and lying to people, and now they're being taken to court in the U.S. It's maybe the beginning of a trend, but I like show yourself. Who are these shadow world operators? Who decides that we can't save our own seats? I was in Parliament when an act was passed, forced through. I worked against it, of course. It was called Plant Breeders' Rights.
C-18 or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, C-18 exactly. And it doesn't sound very dangerous. Plant breeders' rights. Well, it's Monsanto rights. And it says farmers can only save seeds if you're growing something for some obscure heritage purpose and you don't plan to sell the food you grow. Then you know, if you have a museum, you can save the seeds. But if you're actually a farmer, you can't save your seeds. And it was extraordinary how even the parliamentarians who were debating this they said, well, we have to do this because of the treaty we've signed. We have the UPOV 9. We have to do this.
This is misleading because the 27.3b of WTO TRIPS says very clearly, and because I had a role in this, it says breeders' rights or sui generis system, sui generis arising from itself. That's why we were able to write a farmers' rights law in India. And so UPOV 91 is not even mentioned in the WTO. UPOV 91 is being pushed through in the TPP. But, you know, some places the courts are taking up this stuff. But I think we need to set precedents. You know, the learning system was totally corrupted in the time of the scholastics and the domination of the church. That's when people started to create new universities outside the scholastic control. So we need to create new processes and institutions. And we've decided this October, World Food Day, which is 16th of October, but from 14th to 16th, we are organizing a public trial of Monsanto. We're calling it the Monsanto Tribunal. And we are bringing together witnesses from around the world, the doctors who've done the studies on the birth defects in Argentina with the spraying of Roundup, or the peasants who've been forced to pay royalty, or the farmers of India, suicides, Agent Orange victims, people in the United States who are now suing Monsanto on the issue of glyphosate and its poisoning. And we're also saying to everyone, but you know, nothing says we'll only do this in The Hague. You should organize a people's assembly wherever you are. Because slavery didn't end because overnight it was decided slavery should end. Everywhere the outrage of slavery was getting discussed. And to me, this is a new slavery. It's a corporate slavery, but it's a slavery of all of life. Because patents on life is nothing but saying I own and control all life. And I really do hope that you here in Canada will organize people's assemblies wherever. And not only do we want to say, we want to stop a century of ecocide and genocide, but we are sowing the seeds of another future which works for the planet and works for people. And that commitment and the confidence and the courage that the future is ours to shape is what will make these giants irrelevant to our lives. And it's only through their irrelevance will we reduce their power.
So, I want to conclude the part of this evening where, in case you didn't know, the part of our chatting here on stage will end shortly and we will have your questions to Vandana. So don't leave if you don't have to. I just wanted to end on a more positive and hopeful note.
That was a positive note.
Well, that was very positive. Yes, proving their irrelevance is a very important thing. But what I see happening across Canada is in relation to the power of growing your own food and a very strong commitment to food security is a shift in our consciousness in an industrialized society where we've been told for far too long that we are consumers, powerless consumers of the food that the multinationals, which isn't really food by the time they get through with it, that we're entitled, we get to eat the stuff that's overprocessed and nutritionally deprived and provided at great distance and trucked in. And we have a tremendous burgeoning of local agriculture and of farmers markets and of restaurants that say farm to table, of which our friends here, the Stevens, were early proponents. But we know that it's a growing movement. Sometimes it's called foodies, which is to say there's a radical concept that people actually want to eat food that tastes good and also doesn't make them sick. Yes. But I find it incredibly inspiring that within, well, my little riding of Saanich Gulf Islands, just I'll tell you one wonderful story. In the high school on Salt Spring Island, which is called Gulf Island Secondary School, they decided to do something that's completely revolutionary in Canada. They decided that the high school should have a kitchen that actually cooks and prepares food. And they have a school garden and the students grow the food that they get to then help prepare because they have a rotation in the school program that includes cafeteria work. And they grow the food, it's on Salt Spring, then they prepare the food and they serve the food in the high school. That goes against the grain of being powerless consumers because far too many people in our culture don't know how to grow food, don't know how to prepare food, don't know how to cook food, and are very grateful if somebody will do it for them in a way that's delicious. But I think we're on the verge of a real change by saying we have a right to healthy food. We have a right to save seeds. We reject GMOs, we reject your pesticides, we reject poisoning the soil. So you are sowing seeds everywhere you go. But I wanted to think that that is a revolutionary thing in a culture as deprived of self-generating personal power that even is able to imagine. I want to plant a garden. I want to grow my own food. Even in a city, we should do more with urban agriculture. So I'm kind of ranting, but I wanted to make sure that I shared this sense that it's everywhere across Canada is a movement for growing healthy food and having some measure of food security so we're not dependent on trucks that bring us food from California and completely unsustainable agriculture.
You know, we have an ancient text called the Vishnu Puran, and it's very much like the Revelations in the Bible, talking about, you know, bad times and collapse and everything. And then it goes on to say, and in these bad times, very small acts will become hugely significant. And we are in the kind of time where such a mess has been made of the world and our food and of the planet and our democracies, that small acts are now becoming revolutionary acts. Saving seed is revolutionary. Remembering how to grow food is revolutionary. Remembering how to cook food is revolutionary. And the revolution has been made easier because of the extreme stupidity and destruction that go with it. And I would say that one of the things we need to do while we localize is to recognize that everyone has a right to their diversity, their culture, their growing of food. And I do hope that you all will be part of a campaign. I mentioned this is the year of pulses. And Canada this year has emerged as the biggest dumper of bad pulses on India. You know, this yellow pea that they're sending to us is so bad that people, even the poor, won't eat it. So 1,200 crores has been blown up in tax money. And I'm part of the Auditor General's advisory body. And I saw these figures. I said, this is crazy. 7% protein compared to 30% in the real dal and pulses. So every year, Indians are losing 1 million tons of protein through this import. But these pulses fix nitrogen locally. 200 kilograms per acre of nitrogen we can get by growing pulses. And we are losing 1.1 billion tons of good nitrogen in the soil through growing pulses locally. And part of what we have to do is not just grow our gardens and have our school gardens. And, you know, we have a big movement of Gardens of Hope. And it's just exploding. Because all you need to do is give some seeds and some imagination. And you know, you don't have ground in your school. Well, you have a terrace. Yeah. And people are creating gardens on a scale that's absolutely unimaginable. But I think at the same time, while we create gardens, I think the idea of the garden as the planet we live in, and therefore no agribusiness in Canada has a right to trample India's gardens. Well, I think our big challenge is to decommodify. We have to decommodify food, and we've got to decommodify land. And we, you know, in India, India was declared as a place where all corrupt corporations can come and make in India. And the farmland was being grabbed through an ordinance. Once, twice, thrice, the government tried to pass that ordinance. Farmers said, this land is our mother. It's not for sale. And only to the extent that those of us who want to protect the land help build the confidence that the money you get by selling your land or the coercive takeover of land can never, ever compensate for the destruction of the soil which sustains us. We definitely have to have what we have in India, everywhere in the world. You know, we fight for the freedom of the seed, the freedom of the soil, the freedom of the food, the freedom of the water, and our freedom of knowledge. Now, those freedoms are what we need to defend. And this is where the new democracy will get created. It will not get created in the commodity market. It will be created by a shift in thinking, in consciousness, and in our relationship with the earth and each other.
You mentioned Site C. The Peace River. The Peace River region is an extraordinarily rich agricultural zone. I was paddling the Peace River last weekend. I had no idea. On the Peace River, and it has alluvial soils, 15 feet of topsoil. Some of the best topsoil in British Columbia. It can grow cantaloupes. Cantaloupes up there, and watermelon, and beautiful vegetables of all kinds. It will be all flooded, this agricultural land. And then they say, well, there's not very many people producing food. Why are there so few farmers? Well, for decades, BC Hydro has been buying up the land and telling the farmers, your land will be flooded soon, go away. So 34 farm families are holding out. 34 farm families, and there's two of them who've been really fighting hard. The Ken and Arlene Boone and Colin Meek. They've been told by Christy Clark that they have to leave their farms that they've been on for generations by Christmas because they're in the way of the road they want to build. So I urge all of us as British Columbians to really look into the Peace River, look into protecting it, look into the idea that building the dam they want to build will only drive up our hydro rates across BC. It makes no sense economically. And what it communicates is we know so little about food security that we would like to flood some of the best farmland in British Columbia only to lose money later because we won't be able to afford the hydro. And it's all for fracking natural gas in northern BC. Ah. So, I apologize for the rant, but we have to protect the Peace River.
You know, this model of both agriculture and the economy is an extractive model. It extracts wealth from people, it extracts from nature. And the result is homelessness. When I talked about refugees, it is homelessness. Displacement is homelessness. That 80% of central India got displaced this year because of a severe drought. 80% migration. That's the creation of homelessness. Now, this earth is our home. It's oikos. Belonging is the radical act. Refusing to be uprooted by taking care of where you are, whether it's resistance to land grab or it's rebuilding the conditions of life, all of that is basically shaping the new society, the new economy. Not only is homelessness a violation of the human rights of people, but what will happen is just the way the attacks on black people in the US is a way to criminalize those who are victims of inequality. Beyond a point, homelessness will be defined as a crime. And I can see when I talked about the militarized mind, I was, of course, addressing the issue of chemicals that kill or the gene drive mentality. But it is also the coming militarization. You know, what really touched me about the Dallas issue is they killed the person with a robot. It wasn't the police. So they're already deploying military technologies in civic matters. And we have to connect the issue of our ecological rights and duties, our issues of justice, social, cultural, economic, and issues of peace, and build this convergence to resist the violence against the earth, the violence against people, and the militarization of society and the planet. And I can see that if we don't build a strong movement that tries to create nonviolence and peace everywhere, in every relationship, militarization is going to absolutely throttle our capacity to live as free beings in security, and that insecurity will fuel further xenophobia, further fascism, which will fuel further waves of militarized control, And that's exactly what the 1% are seeking, to live behind fortresses. We want to live in a garden. Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you, thank you, thank you.